A very good morning to everyone. On behalf of SEP CRNTS, it's my honor to welcome you all to the webinar series on electron microscopy. An idea which was developed based on our strong electron microscopy analysis on our portfolio of two SEMs with EDS and WDS and three TMs with EDS, STEM and EELS. The first webinar in this series is on the fundamentals of imaging in scanning electron microscope, SEM, which would be given by Professor Amartya Mukhopadhyay. Professor Amartya Mukhopadhyay is an associate professor at the Department of Metallurgical Engineering and Materials Science, IIT Bombay. Professor Amartya has completed his doctoral in materials research from the University of Oxford, UK in 2009 and performed his postdoctoral research at Brown University, USA. His present areas of research includes materials for electrochemical energy storage and engineering ceramics. Amongst his major recognitions so far, he has been awarded with IIT Bombay Research Dissemination Award 2018, INAE Young Engineer Award 2016, ASM IIM North America Visiting Lectureship 2016, IIT Bombay Young Investigator Award 2014, Dr. R. L. Thakur Memorial Award as Young Scientist by the Indian Ceramic Society in 2013 and has also been recognized by the Royal Society of Chemistry UK journals as one of the 2019 emerging investigators. We welcome you, sir, to the webinar series. We are sure that this talk will enlighten the knowledge of the upcoming researchers in the field of electron microscopy and encourage them to use electron microscopes. I would also like to introduce and welcome our HOD, Professor Anil Kotintarail, who has always been an encouragement for us to think beyond just analysis of samples and without any hesitation to help us to come up with such initiatives. At this moment, I would like to inform the participants that this being our first webinar, we would request you to share your feedback. The link for the same will be posted in the question and answer section at the end of the talk. If you have any questions related to the subject, please type it in the question and answer section. We will try to take it up at the end of the talk. Anil sir, may I now request you to speak a few words?
I would give a short presentation to the SIFE and the research facilities that are available at SIFE. So my name is Anil. I am presently heading the SIFE and the CRNTS at IIT Bombay. And welcome to all participants. It's a great pleasure to have you attend this workshop. Okay, so SIFE has a long history. It actually started in 1976. It's a DST, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India supported facility. And then we had a project, this CRNTS Center for Research in Nanotechnology and Sciences, started in 2006, again with funding, initial funding from SIFE, meaning from DST. Okay, and 2008, these two were kind of merged under one umbrella. So both these entities are headed by one person. And then we have, you know, you can see here, SIFE hosts about 16 major equipment, and CRNTS has 5 major equipment. Okay. So we have also, the CRNTS is essentially the academic wing. So we have a PhD program, currently have about 80 plus PhD students. And they are guided by faculty colleagues from other departments. So we have about 65 faculty members from other departments who have been guiding these PhD students and thus involved in the CRNTS and SIFE activities. And CRNTS also hosts about 5 major equipment, and they are basically funded by the Institute, IIT Bombay, but we are also making these facilities available to external users, just along the same lines as SAI facilities. In the financial year 2018-19, we have had about 2,400 users from across the country, and about 21,000 samples were analyzed during this time. Okay, so you can see this inauguration plaque of the building. This was inaugurated by Sri Morarji Desai, the then Prime Minister. This is something that some of you might have seen. So this is a list of facilities. I'll not go into the details here. These are the facilities supported by SAIF, meaning DST. But then you can see some four of them actually highlighted here. So these are the electron microscope related things. And we are going to add another instrument, dual beam FIB FEG system. The system has already arrived at IIT Bombay, and we will be installing them when this pandemic related restrictions are lifted. And the institute facilities at the same building under the CRNTS umbrella are listed here. And again, two electron microscopes are there in this. Okay. Now, this slide actually shows you some details about the five electron microscopes that are present. So we have right now two SEMs. One more will be added. The dual beam also has an electron beam. And we can do imaging and EDS and other STEM and all these things there. And we have three transmission electron microscopes with quite sophisticated capabilities. So all these things are listed on our website. So you can see this, saif.itb.ac.in is the website, and you can actually have a look at the facilities, what are the services offered, how you can actually get your samples analyzed and all the things. So I would welcome you to note this and visit the website. And you can see that, we have users from all over India, and sometimes we also help researchers from neighboring countries, even though our international emphasis is not very much. So we have, you can see this from all over the country, people come here, though we have actually in the country about 17 sites funded by DST and spread all over the country. Okay, despite that, we have a lot of users from all over the country. And we actually, people not just submit samples, they come for visits from universities. We provide them demonstrations of specific instruments of their interest. We also have people from various societies, professional bodies, companies, and so on and so forth coming. We also have a LinkedIn page, so I welcome you to note this. So SAIF IIT Bombay is a profile name, and we make all the announcements about our programs, and highlight publications by users and so on and so forth. So you may want to befriend us on LinkedIn. We would like to be very happy to be connected with you on this. So this particular webinar is the first of its kind. We have lined up a total of 9 webinars in the series on electron microscopy. And I had posted this also on the LinkedIn site. And we will be opening up the other ones, in the sequence for registration. So I welcome you to actually attend the subsequent webinars as well. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. So these are all the staff members of SAIF CRNTS, and they would be very happy to actually help you with your research and development activities. So, Princy, over to you.
Amartya sir, can you start with the presentation?
So, thanks, Princy. My presentation is shared. So, before getting started, first I would like to thank the SAIF CRNTS team for inviting me to make this presentation and tell something about scanning electron microscope. So upfront, you can see a real image of a scanning electron microscope. This is actually a scanning electron microscope with an additional attachment, which is called a focused ion beam, which has a gallium source to bombard the surfaces so that one can image deep down below the surface. But anyway, it's still a scanning electron microscope. And what you can see here is the basic ACM column. I'm going to talk about that. And here you have the sample chamber, not very well visible, where you can keep your sample and close it to, and then get a good vacuum so that it can work. And you can see a few detectors here. There can be a lot of detectors which can be attached to a scanning electron microscope. They can be the backscatter detector, they can be the EDS detector, they can be EBSD detector, catholuminescence detector. There are a variety of detectors which can be attached. And here you can see a scanning electron microscope image, which is taken in a backscattered mode and which shows nice contrasts based on average atomic number difference. So I will also come look into what is backscattered imaging and when it should be done. So with this brief introduction, let me go ahead with my presentation. Screen is not moved, the slide is not changed. Yeah, now it has got changed. Sorry about these goof ups. So here I've listed a few microscopy techniques, like starting with the optical microscopy, which uses the visible light for imaging. And one can immediately see that the resolution is not great. It is about a few microns. But then next comes a scanning electron microscope, which I am going to talk about in more detail today. So it uses, as the name suggests, it uses the electrons for imaging, and one can go up to a very good resolution, up to even 1 nanometer with the modern day equipment. But then with both optical as well as scanning electron microscope, one can just image the surface of the sample or see the morphology of powder particles if one wants to do that. But then with the next one, that is a transmission electron microscopy, one can look deep inside the material to look into various defect substructures and even do some electron diffraction, and which gives a lot of information. And resolution wise, it has one of the best resolution. One can see go up to an angstrom level resolution with the modern day TEMs. Then the next one, which is not an electron microscope per se, but it's like the STM and the AFM series, which uses forces between the atom and the probe tip for doing some imaging. And one can, again here, just like scanning electron microscope or optical microscope, one can look at the surface of the sample and not go deep inside for looking at the various defects, etc., as one can do in a TEM. This shows a basic construction of a scanning electron microscope, and this is the column that I was talking about. The top part is the electron gun, where the electrons are produced and then they are accelerated downwards through the column. And while doing so, the condenser lenses try to focus them into a narrow beam. The better the focus is to a narrow beam, the better will be the resolution. And then towards the bottom, the last set of coils, that is the scanning coils, they help scan the focused electron beam across the entire surface of, or the region of interest on the sample surface. So this is the basic construction. And like I told you, these electromagnetic lenses make most of the difference. If they're able to focus the beam to a very fine diameter or spot size, it gives a very good resolution. And if the scanning is good, so one can scan across the region of interest without much difficulty. Now, coming to the source of the electron beam, it's basically ejection of electron beam from some source and then acceleration of it towards the sample through the column. So the basic type of source is the tungsten filament. it's a sometimes called a tungsten hairpin filament, which is heated so that the electrons can overcome the warp function and get ejected. So this has been there since the start of scanning electron microscopy, the beginning of the scanning electron microscopy or any electron microscopy, whether it's scanning or whether it's transmission. And it is still in use, but it does not lead to a very good resolution. The next one, which is a lanthanum hexaboride, that also works with the same principle, like you have to heat the tips and so that the electrons overcome the warp function and get ejected. So, and the lanthanum hexaboride leads to a little bit more brightness and better resolution as compared to the tungsten hairpin filament. But the more commonly used electron source nowadays is the field emission gun, where with, like along with or without even heating, one can apply an electric field and which energizes the electron to pull them out of the tip, and so one can have the electrons out for the imaging purpose. Now again, field emission guns are also of two types, as I will show in the next slide. So one is called the Schottky source, one is called the cold field cathode. So for the cold field, one just uses the field emission and no heating at all, whereas for the Schottky, one uses a combination of heating as well as the field emission. So let's compare the different electron sources here. So if one looks at the tungsten, one can immediately see that the source size and the energy spread, they are quite large, which is not ideal for high resolution imaging. And the moment one goes to the field emission guns, whether it's Schottky or whether it's cold field, one can see that the source size and the energy spread have got considerably reduced. On the other hand, the brightness have got considerably enhanced compared to the tungsten filament. And so these help in high resolution imaging because it leads to a lot of signal from a finer region of the sample, and one can get good quality image and look like get a very good resolution. However, among Schottky and cold field, even though the cold field is the best in terms of performance, but then one can see that the service life is a bit lesser as compared to the Schottky, and also the requirement of vacuum is a bit more stringent as compared to the Schottky. So typically the Schottky field emission gun is the more commonly used, but for really good work, one would like to have the cold field gun as the best possible electron source. Now, for like once the electron beams are focused onto the sample, they lead to the generation of lot of different types of signals which can be used for various purposes, imaging as well as spectroscopy, or like detection of which elements are present, and one can also get information, or not directly, on the compounds that may be present from the elemental analysis. So now for imaging, the two main electron types are the secondary electron and the backscattered electron. When secondary electron is primarily used for the imaging of the topography of the sample, of the surface of the sample, whereas backscattered imaging, though it can be used for topography, it is typically used for getting an atomic number contrast, similar to what I had shown in my first slide, the title slide. So that was a image taken using the backscattered electron. Then for the detecting the elements present in a given region, one uses the characteristic X-rays which get generated when the high energy electrons get impinged on the sample. And the technique which uses them is typically the EDS, the energy dispersive spectroscopy. There is another technique which is even more useful, especially for quantification, that is called the wavelength dispersive spectroscopy, or WDS. I don't think today I'm going to talk about WDS, but there is another talk dedicated to EDS as well as WDS, where it will be dealt in more detail. Then there are other signals like photons, which can lead to like the cathodoluminescence, and then Auger electron, which can again be used for the elemental analysis from a region more close to the surface. For a typical ACM usage, it is the first three types of signals which are more commonly used and which are very useful, and that is the secondary electron, backscattered electron for imaging, and the characteristic X-rays for the elemental analysis. So one needs to understand like what causes a difference between the secondary electrons and the backscattered electrons in terms of what they can image and what gives a better resolution to the secondary electrons. So from this picture, which is typically the how the interaction of the electron with the material of the sample takes place, one can see that the secondary electrons come out from a region which is very, very close to the surface of the sample, and so does the Auger electrons. However, the backscattered electrons can get emitted from a much greater depth and from a much greater lateral region of the below the surface of the sample. And the characteristic X-rays used for the elemental analysis via the EDS or WDS, they come out from even a greater depth and even a greater spread over the lateral dimension. So accordingly, one can immediately realize that for getting a good resolution, it is the secondary electrons which are limited to a lesser depth below the surface of the sample, and the lateral spread is also less. They can be more useful as compared to the backscattered electrons. When we talk about secondary electrons, the word secondary has some meaning. That is because these secondary electrons are not really the electrons which get impinged onto the sample from the electron source, but they are the electrons which are released by the atoms closer to the surface because of collision with the primary electrons which are coming from the source. So the secondary electrons are actually the electrons belonging to the material which is being looked into, and hence the name secondary, not primary. So as one can see, these are low energy electrons, and accordingly only those which are generated close to the surface of the sample, or depth which is shallow with respect to the surface, only they can come out and they can be used for the imaging. And accordingly they give a good topography because the electrons which are used for the imaging are restricted to a lesser depth below the surface of the sample. By contrast, the backscattered electrons are not really the secondary electrons. They are the primary electrons which get turned back due to the interaction with the electromagnetic field of the atoms. And so when these electrons which are turned back and hence called backscattered, when they come out and if they are captured by the detector, they give an information with respect to the average atomic number of the region from where they came out. Because the greater is the average atomic number, the more will be the number of electrons that will be turned back or backscattered. Hence, the greater will be the average atomic number of a region, the brighter it will appear in the backscattered electron image. And so, if you again recall the image that had shown in the title slide, there were some regions which were gray in appearance and some tiny dots which were really bright and white in appearance. It is those tiny dots which are brighter, they have a greater average atomic number as compared to the gray surrounding of them. Now, so the contrast or the brightness depends on the yield of the secondary and the backscattered electrons. So which is basically the number of electrons, whether it's secondary or backscattered, emitted with respect to the number of electrons which were getting incident or impinged onto the sample. Now various aspects influence the yield. So the atomic number influences the yield for the backscattered electrons, and also the accelerating voltage using which the electrons get impinged onto the sample surface, and the tilt of the specimen surface, the asperities, they also influence the yield, which are more useful for the imaging the secondary electron or the topography contrast. So this is a plot which shows how the yield for the backscattered and the secondary electrons depend on the atomic number, and one can clearly see while the yield of the backscattered increase with increase in the atomic number of the region of interest or of the particular region which one would like to look, or the particular feature which one would like to image. So the yield of the backscattered increases with the atomic number, whereas the yield of the secondary electron, they are not really dependent on the atomic number. Hence, the backscattered electrons, as opposed to the secondary electrons, are useful for the for imaging the contrast between regions or between features having different average atomic number. And in other words, so backscattered electrons are used for the compositional contrast. So now coming to the compositional or elemental analysis via EDS. So like I mentioned, it is basically the characteristic X-rays which are like fingerprint for each element that is present, which are used for the compositional analysis via EDS. So it is the energy or the wavelength of the X-rays which are coming out that gets detected, and then they can tell from which element the characteristic X-ray is coming out or to which element it belongs to. And this can lead to a good analysis of the element that is present or the elements that are present in a given region. However, one needs to be very careful and cautious while using EDS, because EDS does not do a good job till carbon in the periodic table from the beginning. So for lighter elements, it does not do a good job at all. And for quantitative, at least up to oxygen, it really does not do a good job. So from carbon to oxygen in the periodic table, one can get a good qualitative analysis, but for quantification, one needs to be very careful. But beyond oxygen, the quantification is pretty okay. But then one have to keep in mind that the characteristic X-rays are getting generated and are captured by the EDS detector, not just from the surface, but a greater depth below the surface and also greater lateral region. Hence, there will be signals which are coming not just from the feature which one is interested in or where one is focusing the beam, but from the region surrounding the feature. The signals will be captured, the X-ray signals will be captured, and they will also show up in the form of the giving an impression that some elements are present in the feature, but they may be just coming from the region surrounding the particular feature of interest. So this is a typical EDS spectrum taken by the Oxford EDS instrument, and one can see the various elements that are present in a given region of the material. And from these, one can indirectly get an idea of the compounds that may be present. But again, one needs to be very cautious about this, because like I told, the quantification for oxygen is not great. And again, correlating the element that is present with its oxide, it may not work for something like a transition metal, because one does not get any information about the oxidation state of the transition metal via an EDS. So one may, when it's a transition metal, one may think that it is FeO, but it may actually be Fe2O3. So converting the elemental signals to oxides to get a composition of say glasses or ceramics may not be the right thing to do, because of two reasons. One, the oxygen quantification is not great. Second, when there is a transition metal, one does not have any idea about the oxidation state of a transition metal just via EDS. This is a backscattered electron image, and along with EDS, so one can see the brightest contrast is given by a phase which has more molybdenum in it. And as we know, among these, moly is the heavier or having the highest atomic number. And so this has more moly in it, as can be seen from the X-ray, from the EDS analysis. Now, the another contrast is a little bit bright, but not as bright as this one. And one can see there is presence of some moly in that. And the rest of the rest of the region that has a grayish appearance, there is no moly in that. Hence, the backscattered imaging along with the EDS gives an idea that not one, not two, but three types of phases are present. But to know what is the exact phase, one would have to resort to X-ray diffraction and not just EDS or ACM, because EDS can give, okay, there is some moly in this phase, and it, which is more than what the amount of moly present in this phase. And of course, there is no moly present in this phase. And this is giving the contrast difference. And one can visually see how the three phases are distributed, but one cannot, just from this, one cannot figure out what the phase corresponds to, unless one has idea from the idea from X-ray diffraction or complementary techniques. This is a nice pretty picture showing a EDS mapping over a two-dimensional region. So the different regions have different elements, which with the help of the image processing, one can put colors to it and make the image look really nice as well as informative. So this on the right hand side, it shows how the interaction region varies with the accelerating voltage. The importance of this will come towards the end of my presentation. So one can see at low accelerating voltage, the interaction region is lesser and the interaction region becomes greater as the accelerating voltage gets increased. Immediately one can realize that the lower the accelerating voltage, the resolution might be better, and that might be also be good for imaging topography. And so like similarly, with respect to atomic number, the higher the atomic number of the region of interest, the lower will be the interaction volume, and that can lead to a greater resolution with respect to topography imaging. This is more like a summary of what I have discussed till now. Like secondary electrons come out and are imaged from a much lesser depth and lateral spread below the surface of the sample, whereas backscattered electrons come from a much greater depth and lateral spread, and the characteristic X-rays which are used for EDS, they come from an even greater depth and lateral spread, and so the resolutions of imaging go down from the left to the right hand side. So it is, the resolution is best for secondary electron imaging, poor for backscattered electron, or not as great as that for secondary electron, and it is not really great for the for any imaging or analysis done using EDS. These next few slides will have some examples of imaging trying to show different aspects. This is an image which first shows the secondary electron imaging from a given region, then the backscattered imaging from the same region. From secondary electron imaging, one can see the topography, the valleys and the protruded regions. One can clearly observe that. Whereas from the backscattered imaging, one cannot really get an idea of the valleys and the protrusions, but one can get some contrast. One can see those white or brighter dots, which indicate that there are secondary phase present in these regions. Now, there are, for some ACMs, there are modes which try to image topography based on backscattered imaging, but they look good, but one should be very cautious, because if one compares these two images, this is a topography via secondary electron imaging, and this is a topography, so-called topography, via backscatter, like using the backscattered electrons, and one can see that this image can be totally misleading with respect to the topography. So one would ideally not like to see topography using backscattered imaging. Now there is some microscopes which allow you a combination of like the topography as well as the atomic number contrast via backscattered and secondary electron imaging. But like, to be honest, if one compares these two images with this, this neither gives a good resolution or good imaging with respect to topography, nor does it give a good image quality with respect to the backscattered. So given to me, I would image a secondary electron image separately and a backscattered electron image separately from a given region, from the same region, and which will give me the real complementary information. this is a set of image which shows how the microstructure evolves during aging treatment of some solid solution, which is basically formation of some precipitate during elongated elongated holding at some high temperature from a solid solution. Now one can see the precipitation occurring at discrete regions, which are basically great boundary triple points. I don't want to go into detail of that. And then with progressing time, some of the earlier front precipitates are coarsening and some tiny precipitates are appearing inside the grains, and which are again becoming brighter and also coarsening. And so this shows a nice evolution of the microstructure with progressing time. And this is typically using a backscattered imaging. And for some more support, one can use EDS along with that to see that the brighter particles have more iron in that, which is heavier, and the gray matrix has less iron in that, which is which has a lesser contrast. Now, again, for the same material, one can see that there are not just two contrasts, but three contrasts. One is the gray matrix, which has hardly any iron in that. Then there are brighter particles, which have some iron in that. But then there are even more bright particles close to the surface of the sample, if this is the surface. And those have even greater iron content, as one can see by qualitatively comparing the EDS. Again, I would not really emphasize too much on the quantification, but qualitatively one can see that this feature has more iron and hence brighter as compared to this feature. And with the help of X-ray diffraction, one can get an idea that this might probably be elemental iron and this might be iron aluminate spinel. So all I want to emphasize here is that it should be backscattered imaging coupled with EDS and then X-ray diffraction, so that one can get a complete information about the type of phases that are present in a given material. So it cannot be just backscattered imaging and just EDS, because that can lead to misleading results. Because one can see even in signal coming from this region, or one would think that is coming from this region, which is primarily metallic iron, one can see the presence of aluminium in the ETS signal, because that is coming from the surrounding region, and one cannot avoid that using EDS. So if one uses just EDS for trying to understand what this particular phase is, it can be very misleading. Similar to a couple of slides earlier, this again shows the progress of how the microstructure evolves using backscattered imaging with progress in heat treatment of a solid solution. So I can skip this slide for time constraints, but one can see that backscattered imaging can lead to really good image if it is done under good conditions. Now this is an image of a fractured surface if one wants to study the fractography. And the ideal mode for that is the secondary electron imaging, because for fracture surface, one would really like to see how the topography looks like. So these are all the three are secondary electron images. But again, given a chance, backscattered electron imaging can play some role if there is a flatter region on the fractured surface. And this is a backscattered imaging, and it shows that shows the presence of secondary phase particles on the fractured surface. So this gives an additional complementary imaging. But again, when the surface is not really smooth, as in this one, backscattered imaging can be quite misleading, because it may or may not lead to the contrast difference despite the presence of a second phase particles. So these are cross-section images with the cross-section done using the FIB or the focused ion beam mode of the dual beam FIB ACM. So these are electrodes for application in lithium-ion battery, and after the cross-sectioning is done in the FIB mode, one can use backscattered imaging to image different regions of the multi-layer, and one can do that very nicely. And also here one can see there is one region, the substrate is copper, and there is another layer which is a composite of tin and tin copper intermetallics, and one can see the difference in contrast between the tin and tin copper intermetallic phases. Now, after the examples, coming back to some of the operation parameters, now talking about accelerating voltage, if one would remember, in one of the earlier slides, I had shown that the interaction read volume goes down if one uses a lower voltage, which means that most of the signal is coming from a region closer to the surface, which means it will give a good topography and a good resolution in terms of topography. So one can see that for the same region at lower accelerating voltage, one can see a much better topography and all these ridges, etc. Whereas for the same region at higher accelerating voltage, one really cannot see all these features and the topographic information very clearly. But one needs to note that this is at a magnification of the 7000, which is a low magnification. But one, when one wants to image something at a higher magnification, one would need a higher accelerating voltage, because one needs greater signals for imaging from a very tiny region. Because the, when one is going for a higher magnification, one would like to image regions which are really tiny, few nanometers in size. For that, one would need greater signals that are coming out from those regions, from those tiny region of the specimen. And because of that, one would need to go to higher accelerating voltage. So all I want to emphasize here is that one has to select the accelerating voltage depending on the type of imaging or depending on the requirement of imaging for the features that are present. One thing I would like to mention here, and it's also mentioned in like below, that this, the what you are seeing on this slide, I'm using it just for illustrative purposes, but it is not the right thing to do, because for any micrograph, one should have a scale bar showing the like giving an idea of this dimension of the feature, which are somehow missing here. But anyway, for illustration, this is okay. But this is not the ideal way to present a micrograph, because one should have the scale bar, as one can see in any of the other images. Like one can see a scale bar here, which tells me that this thickness of this layer may be, say, 0.25 micron or so. Anyway, coming to the operation parameter, again, like the same aspect, at higher KB, one would like to image something like nanoparticles, nano features, because one would like to get good enough signal. But when one is trying to image topography at a lower magnification, one should go for a lower accelerating voltage. And the like the various effects of high and low accelerating voltage are shown here. And another problem with high accelerating voltage is that it can do some damage to the surface. It can also cause charging if the surface is not conducting. And those effects can be avoided at a lower accelerating voltage. And for backscatter contrast, yes, if one goes to a higher accelerating voltage, one can get a better backscatter contrast, as one can see by comparing these two images. In addition to accelerating voltage, working distance, which is basically the distance between the surface of the sample and the last pole piece of the electromagnetic lenses. So that also makes a difference. So again, if one wants to have a low magnification imaging, focusing more on the topography contrast, one would prefer a higher working distance. However, if one wants a higher resolution imaging for imaging, say, nanoparticles or nanosize features, one may have to go for a lower working distance. Again, something called spot size, which is the size of the diameter of the electron beam, which is focused onto the surface of the sample. The finer the spot size, the greater is the resolution. However, the finer the spot size, the lesser is the intensity of the signals or the number of signals that are coming out from a given region. Hence, for using smaller spot size or for higher resolution imaging, one would typically like to have FEG or field emission gun as the electron source as compared to the tungsten filament. This is one of the aberrations in a scanning electron microscope or any electron microscope, that is astigmatism. It happens when the electromagnetic lenses do not behave as if they are spherically symmetric. So then, like on going on either side of the focus, one can see that the image starts streaking or elongating in one particular direction, and on going to the other side of the focus, it starts elongating in another orthogonal direction. and somewhere in between one gets a decent focus, but it's not of a good quality. So this kind of feature suggests that the problem is related to astigmatism, one of the very common aberrations which come up even during operation, and one has to correct that aberration by making the getting the spherical symmetry back in the electromagnetic lenses. One more problem which is typically faced if the sample is not conducting, like ceramic samples, the rock samples for art sciences, etc., the polymer samples which are not conducting, so is charging. That happens because when the electron beam once focused onto the sample, the cannot escape and cannot go away. So that interferes with further electron beam coming and impinging the sample, the same region or the surrounding region. So, and it can give lot of funny appearance, like very brightening, problem with focus, etc. And that is related to the charging. So the solution is, if one is trying to image a sample which is not electronically conducting, one needs to put a thin conducting layer on the surface of the sample. And this thin conducting layer can be a gold palladium coating, which is usually used for low magnification imaging. For high magnification imaging, this gold coating is not good because the gold particles start showing up. So for high magnification imaging or high resolution imaging, one would typically use a platinum coating or a carbon coating. Where carbon coating, if not done properly, can create some dirty patches in the region, but those can be avoided. So coating the surface of the sample, but that is not enough. One has to put a conducting tag from the surface to the base of the sample where it is in contact with the conducting holder or the conducting base. So unless this tag is provided either by a copper tape or some silver tag, then again the electrons will just stay on the surface of the sample and will not have a chance to escape. So for non-conducting samples, this is an important sample preparation step. One has to coat it properly but thin enough so that it does not interfere with the imaging. And in addition to coating, one has to put a conducting pathway from the surface of the sample to the base of the or to the holder. Other than that, ACM does not really involve any sample preparation. As long as the sample can fit into the sample chamber, one can just put that in and start imaging, but one has to make sure that the sample surface is clean, because any contamination which can happen even from the atmosphere will create some funny appearances, as you can see in this image. So for cleaning, typically one would recommend that one does ultrasonication in say acetone, ethanol, etc. before putting the sample in the ACM chamber. And after such cleaning, one should never ever touch the sample with a bare hand before putting it in the ACM chamber, because touching by bare hand will lead to additional contamination, and it can really prevent good imaging, and it will also make the sample chamber and the column of the microscope dirty, and it can lead to malfunctioning of the microscope. So that is very important. The sample after proper cleaning should not be touched by bare hand at all. It can only be touched by wearing a proper glove. So with this, let me thank my research group. Like whatever I do for any of my research, the entire enthusiasm comes from my research group. So I would like to thank all my research group members and to all the participants here for listening to my presentation. And with this, I can take up any question which may have come from the participants' side. So thank you for listening.
Thank you, sir, for the enlightening presentation. I'm sure that many of us have questions in their mind, which they can write in the question and answer section post. We hope to answer most of them today. Most popular questions which popped up are, what are Auger electrons?
Oh, okay. So Auger electrons are basically one knows what is a characteristic X-ray, right? So when there is a electron which has been ejected out, from one of the lower orbitals, electron from a higher orbital will fall to take its place and release energy in the form of X-ray. Now these X-rays can, instead of them coming out, can also knock out an electron, and this electron which if knocked out by the X-ray, instead of the X-ray coming out, is the Auger electron. So that's the Auger electron, and so these Auger electrons having very less energy, they can escape only from a very shallow depth from the surface of the sample, below the surface of the sample.
One question is how number of signals are related to accelerating voltage?
Number of signals are related to accelerating voltage. Okay, so if the accelerating voltage is higher, the energy of the impinging electrons are higher. So then the electrons which are getting ejected will also have a higher energy, and even so then because of higher energy, even those which are coming from a greater depth, they can also come out of the surface of the sample and they can be used for imaging. So accordingly there will be more signals, but since some of the electrons will be coming out from a greater depth, it kind of compromises on the resolution that can be achieved.
Okay, so another interesting question is, what is the material used for coating activated carbon during STM analysis?
Sorry, I could not hear you properly.
What is the material used for coating activated carbon during STM analysis?
Coating what carbon?
Activated.
Can you repeat?
Activated carbon?
Activated carbon, right. Okay, see, activated carbon usually has good enough conductivity for being imaged without coating. So it's really not needed to coat activated carbon. Any carbonaceous materials can be used without putting a conducting coating.
Okay. One of the participants wants to know about sample preparation for SEM imaging, specifically for solid sintered ceramics.
Yeah, that's what I talked about. So there is no such methodology for sample preparation in an SEM, unlike in a GEM. So all one has to ensure is the surface of the sample is clean, and if it's a ceramic which is not electronically conducting, there is a conducting coating which is put on the top, thin enough for not interfering with the imaging, but a nice thorough coating. And in addition to that, tag from the coated surface to the base, so that makes a contact between the surface of the sample and the holder, which is also a metallic holder. So that's all basically, and one has to ensure that it fits into the chamber of the ACM. That's all. But for powder sample, one should ensure that the powder is stuck properly, say on a sticky copper tape or sticky carbon tape, whatever, so that the powders don't fly off while creating the vacuum, because if that does, it will contaminate the column a lot.
So does the primary electron cause background noise during the signal detection? How do we differentiate between the primary and the secondary electron?
Primary electron and the secondary electron. See, primary electron means the electrons which are generated by the electron gun which are impinging on the sample, and the secondary electrons are basically coming out because they are ejected by, because these high energy electrons are getting impinged on the sample, and they are ejecting electrons from the outer shell of the atoms of the surface of the sample, so which are basically not the same electrons as the electron beam, hence they are the secondary electrons. But then the backscattered electrons are actually the primary electrons which are getting backscattered. So they have different ways of getting detected because of the difference in their energy which they have.
Thank you, sir. Sir, in principle, is it a correct way to call a composite of two ceramics, MgO plus MgFe2O4, a ceramic alloy?
Could you please repeat?
In principle, is it correct way to call a composite of two ceramics, MgO and MgFe2O4, a ceramic alloy?
Mg-Fe2O4, it is preferred to call it as a alloy rather than a composite. But again, there is this alloys and composites, at some point there is not much of a borderline between them. Typically, if a component of, say, the second phase can dissolve into the matrix and has some good interaction with the matrix material, then it is typically known as an alloy. Like in MgL2O4, in MgO, the components can dissolve in MgO. So it is, by that definition, it is an alloy. It is not a composite. Something like, say, magnesia with carbon. Because the carbon has no interaction as such with the matrix, it will not dissolve as such. So then that can be called as a composite, like say magnesia carbon nanotube, it's a composite.
Okay. So another question is, for polymer samples, which electrons give better results with the SE imaging or BSE imaging?
Secondary and backscattered imaging are for totally different purposes. One is for topography as well, and the other is for compositional contrast. So that does not really depend whether it's a polymer or a ceramic as such. So if somebody wants to image the topography, one would use a secondary electron. If one wants to map different regions or like image regions having different atomic number, one would use a backscattered imaging. That is nothing to do with the polymer.
Okay, sir. So time is running up. Thank you so much. Over to you, Mayura.
Thank you, Aradhana. On behalf of SEB CRNTS, I would like to thank Professor Amarta Mukhopadhyay for the very insightful talk on fundamentals of imaging in scanning electron microscope. We are really grateful to you, Professor Mukhopadhyay, for answering questions asked by the participants. I would also like to thank our head, Professor Anil Kotienthrail, for his continued support in this webinar series. At last, I thank all the participants for attending this webinar and making this event successful. A link for the feedback form is shared in the question and answer section. Please fill this form. Your valuable inputs are important for our further improvement. The registration link for the next webinar is now open on our website. The talk is on Transmission Electron Microscopy, Imaging and Spectroscopy by Professor Leela Panchakarla. I request you all to join us for our next talk. Once again, thank you all for making this webinar successful. Stay healthy and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. So,
thank you, everyone.
Thanks a lot to all.
Thank you, Amartya. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.